So Vasudeva Sutam Devam, one who is the son of Vasudeva, one who is a Deva, who is literally Deva means one who is shining, resplendent. Vasudeva Sutam Devam, a divine being, that also is the meaning. Kamsa Chanura Mardhanam, one who has killed Kamsa and Chanura. Devaki Paramanandam, one who brings, who is the great joy of Devaki, Krishna Mande Jagat Guru. Salutations to that Lord Krishna, who is the teacher of the whole world. Very simple meaning, but very nice symbolism it has, that Krishna is born to whom? Vasudeva and Devaki. So Vasudeva is the symbol of a sharp and a subtle intellect. And Devaki is the symbol of a pure and devoted mind. When we have a pure and devoted mind, and we have a sharp and subtle intellect, Lord Krishna will be born within us. So Vasudeva Sutam Devam and Devaki Paramananda. Externally, the story-wise, all of you know, so I will not go into the details of that. Then it is said, Kamsa Chanura Mardhanam, one who destroyed Kamsa and Chanura. So in the story, Kamsa is the brother, is the uncle of Lord Krishna. Symbolically, what is the meaning of Kamsa? Kamsa means the ego. If you split Kamsa, who is he? One who goes on asking who is the Lord, where is the Lord, I don't believe in the Lord. That small individual ego that always comes up, who is he, who am I, that distinction who keeps on making, who lives in limitation, that entity that is called the ego comes up. And Chanura is, Uras means the chest. So Chanura is one who has is a broad-chested person, meaning very proud. So basically it is ego and ego-centric desires. One who has destroyed both these, that Supreme Lord is Krishna, who is the joy of Devaki. Meaning a mind which has surrendered will experience the supreme joy. Paramanandam. The word Devaki also is very nice. Now if you split Devaki, what will you get? Dev and Ki. So Devaki ho gayi. One who has become one with the Lord or who has surrendered to the Lord. So one who experiences that. So Devaki Paramanandam. And Krishnam Vande Jagat Guru. Salutations to Sri Krishna, who is the teacher of the whole world. As the giver of the knowledge of the Gita itself, is the teacher of the whole world, being a universal book. But as Ishvara, Krishna is as Ishvara is the teacher of the whole world. Not only human beings, all the beings. Who teaches the birds how to fly and how to find their food, and who teaches the animals to build their own homes and protect themselves and all that. The teacher is in hearts of each one. The knowledge is there in the hearts of each one, and the inner teacher, the guru, is one who prompts the individual. So as Ishvara we have to understand Krishna Mande Jagat Guru, as the Lord is the guru of all the beings. So that's the meaning. Now in the second chapter, last class, we saw about this fact about reincarnation. How Arjuna has surrendered to Sri Krishna, and then from different perspectives Bhagavan is telling him why he should do his duty, why he should fight the war. So one perspective we saw was that if you feel that you are going to destroy these beings, these Bhishma, Drona, etc. Neither they were not there in the past, nor that they will cease to exist in the future. Only this form will not be there. So he hinted about reincarnation, and we saw the details about reincarnation. Why it is a fact from logic, from scripture statements, and from experiential proofs. Now Bhagavan goes on to say that one who has mind which is balanced, who remains equanimous in the pairs of opposites, that person is one who will be able to understand this truth about reincarnation also, as well as is ready for experiencing immortality. So one of the very famous portions of the Gita, the next two verses, the 14th and 15th verse of the second chapter, they speak about equanimity in the pairs of opposites. Because life is such that we will go through pairs of opposites. Heat and cold, pleasure and pain, success and failure, praise and criticism. How much we are able to maintain our balance amidst these pairs of opposites, that determines the inner strength of that person. So to keep the mind calm in all situations, that is the sadhana. To go up with excitement, to go down with dejection, that is ordinary. Anybody will go through that. The ability to remain balanced, remain strong, remain focused, not allow the situation to overpower, that is the sadhana. So Gurudev always said that when the mind is calm, the intellect is sharp. And the decisions are rational, right and rewarding. If the mind is disturbed, then the intellect cannot think properly. That is what happened to Arjuna. Emotions overwhelmed him, couldn't think properly, came to a wrong decision, I want to quit the war. Luckily he had that ability to at least surrender and postpone the decision. Did we discuss this part earlier? That if we are disturbed emotionally, and we cannot control the mind at that point in time, and the agitation is persisting, at least what we should do is postpone decision making. In that situation, don't decide. Because chances are that in that situation we will take a wrong decision. So many relationships also break like that. Something we just say and then we take a decision that I will never meet this person again. I will never interact with him. I will never do this. Mind gets very agitated. Then one decision one takes in haste. Impulsively one may drop some business plan that one was working on. Impulsively some decision when it is taken, it will hurt, it will affect. So if emotionally the mind is disturbed, one should postpone decision making. One say, no, not now, later. I will decide later. So how to keep this mind balanced in all the pairs of opposites? This is the second chapter, 14th verse. One of the important ways to do that is to learn to accept life with its pairs of opposites. Acceptance is a very powerful means. It is not complacency. Once I accept the situation as it is, then only I know how to respond to it in the most objective way. Otherwise we won't know. We will be clouded. So acceptance is a very powerful method. Resistance to life is what brings all the agitation. And why this happened to me? I don't want this. I do not desire this. If something has come to me, there would be some reason why it has come. Even if it is not desirable to me, I need to accept it first. Acceptance doesn't mean that I should agree with what has happened. That is not called acceptance. Complacency and agreement is not equal to acceptance. Suppose some business loss happened, some accident happened, some heartbreak happened, some such thing happened, which is not agreeable to me. That does not mean that I don't accept that, fine, this has happened now, what next? Same way the positive also. So agreement, if I learn to accept something, need not mean that I agree that this is right and I am going to be complacent about it. Not at all. I have accepted that this is the situation. If it is summer, it is hot. I may not agree with that, that it should be like this only. But I have to accept it. This is the way it is. Right now it is hot. Now what can I do about it? I can stay indoors. I can wear sunglasses. I can put some sunscreen lotion. Whatever. That next steps I can take. But I have to accept that it is hot. The denial mode and resisting mode is what wastes a lot of our time and energy. When I am in a denial mode, I will not even accept the situation, then I can't find a solution for it. So many times we are in a denial mode for any weakness, so then we can't work on it. Or we are in a justifying mode, anybody else in my situation also would have been like that. Or we are resisting, no. This should not happen to me like this. Acceptance is not any of these. If I accept, this is the situation, if I accept externally also and internally also. Internally, okay, I have a certain weakness, let us say I am irritable or I am angry. That is one limitation in my personality. If I accept it, then I can start working on it. Acceptance doesn't mean that I agree, I justify, I become complacent. Lot of people say that if you become accepting, then complacency will set in. Complacency doesn't set in because of acceptance. Complacency sets in because of attachment. That I am attached to something else which is more comforting to me. That's why I am complacent. Like a simple example, if I want to get up in the morning and go for a jog, if I accept that yes, I have an issue with sleep, that I love sleep more than jogging, what will I do? I will take efforts towards it. If I accept that, does that make me complacent or my attachment to sleep makes me complacent? My attachment to sleep makes me complacent, not my acceptance that I have a particular tendency and now I must work on it. If I accept it, I will work on it. That, you know, this is not good for my health, so let me work on it. So acceptance is a very powerful, important aspect for any personality change also to happen, for any transformation also to happen outside. Hence, we must know that life will bring pairs of opposites. Why resist when a negative or unpleasant thing happens? heat and cold, pleasure and pain, success and failure, they go together only. They cannot be isolated. Only happiness I want. It cannot happen. Only heat should be there or only cold should be there. It won't happen. The nature of the world is pairs of opposites. So if I understand that, if there will be 10 people who praise me, there will be another 5 people who will criticize. It is natural. So once we know that we learn to accept life with its flow. A lot of people say, no, flow with the flow or go with the flow. The flow, there will be ups and downs. How to maintain the balance in that? That's the second chapter, 14th verse. Let's chant it again. Matra sparshastu kaunteya, shitoshna sukha dukha daha, agamapaino nityaha, tam stitikshasva bharata. The next one also. Yam hi navyathayantyete, purusham purusharshabha, samadukha sukham dhiram, somrutatvaya kalpate. Matra sparshastu kaunteya. When the senses contact the sense objects in the world. Kaunteya means one who is very sharp. In O Kunti's son, you are so sharp and alert. Be alert that when your senses contact the sense objects, meaning when we interact with the world, these pairs of opposites will arise. Ushna, heat and cold, sukha dukkha, happiness and sorrow, etc. Meaning at body level, heat and cold, emotional level, happiness and sorrow, intellectual level, success and failure. This will arise. Adamaha apayina. They come and they go. Tans titikshasva. Just bear them. Titiksha means forbearance. Just bear them without wasting energies. Otherwise, they go on complaining. Why this is like that, why that is like that, I don't like this, I don't like that. Half the time goes in fighting with all that. They just bear them. Many times, you know, Gurudev used to be like that. He just, sometimes he will be writing his letters and it will be freezing cold, but he is so absorbed in writing his letters, there is not even a shawl around him or anything. If it is hot, it is hot. If it is cold, it is cold. If I can do something, I do it. If I can't, leave it. Nike has this tagline, no? The tagline is what? Just do it. So if I can do something, I must just do it. If I cannot do anything, just drop it. Successful people are those who will do what they can and who will drop what they can't. Otherwise, people, we fight with things which we cannot do anything about and don't do what we can do. So time and energy gets wasted. So here once he says this, that just bear it. Titiksha is the quality of forbearance where I don't distract my mind away from the goal and bear the tiny pinpricks that life brings. Some unpleasantness, some difficulty, some challenges. Why get perturbed so much? One exercise one can do, if you like to do. Count every day how many times I got disturbed. Now, nowadays they have this Fitbit, no? It counts how many steps and how much water you drank and whatever. Like that, there should be some meter which will record. The moment you get little angry, it measures your blood pressure and says, I got it, you got irritated. I don't know whether the equipment is still able to do all that, but mentally you can count. And it is a very powerful method to actually bring in a change. Because when I realize that in a day I am getting disturbed at least 15, 20 times or I don't know how many times, we keep a count, it is like a mirror to oneself. And if I am coming to spirituality, I am practicing sadhana, I am becoming selfless, I am doing seva, etc. Has that reduced? It will reduce if I become alert about it. So titiksha is to not allow the mind to be disturbed. Just bear it. Tiny pinpricks, there will be some unpleasantness, something which will not be fine. Now one brahmachari, he went to Gurudev. This is the early days of Santipani Sadhana, where he, the Pavai Ashram, where we study Vedanta course. So he went to Gurudev and he complained to Swamiji that, Swamiji, we are not able to sleep properly. There are so many mosquitoes there, and what to do with this? And so Swamiji fired him. He said, you came here to sleep or to get awakened? What is your duty? After some days, another brahmachari came like that. So he said, yes, these mosquitoes are my tiny soldiers to keep you alert and awake. Let them be there. Ultimately, he got some rods put and some mosquito net put, etc. But the point is, when you can't do anything, just bear it. So, tiny pinpricks, one should not bother. What is the focus? Keep the focus. Now, why that is important? He says, yam hina vyatha yantyete. When these pairs of opposites, they don't disturb a person. Purusham purusha shabha, that person is a strong person. He is the bull amongst men, meaning he is a noble and he is a strong person. Samadukha sukham dhiram, that person who is equanimous in this happiness and sorrow, saha amritatvaya kalpate, that person is fit for immortality. Meaning, as long as pairs of opposites are there and I identify with them, I will remain bound to this level of the individuality. If I want immortality, if I want to experience my nature as supreme happiness, equanimity in both is very crucial. So it is not only for performance in one's work, for improving efficiency, for increasing productivity, or for harmony in relationships, or for personal peace and happiness, but more for spiritual growth also, equanimity is very crucial. Not to be disturbed. One of the ideal examples, maybe very tough to follow, but the way he lived it is Eknath Maharaj. People sent, instigated people to go and insult him from different community. Go there, and when Eknath Maharaj comes out, not only hurl verbal abuses, but even, spit on him, make him feel impure. Because they were jealous of Eknath Maharaj and his popularity. So it is said 108 times this person spat on Eknath Maharaj and insulted him. Verbally abused him. And every time he spat on Eknath Maharaj, he would go down, take bath in the river, again come back. Not once he lost his balance of mind. This person who had come to insult him, ultimately he fell at his feet and he said, I am extremely sorry that I did this to you, but I was instigated by people. That was my weakness that I fell for it. You are truly a saint and I am extremely sorry. Please forgive me. Just imagine 108 times. Maybe very tough, and we should also know when to follow that. We should not misinterpret that. That misunderstanding and misinterpretation also has led us, our country also, to a lot of trouble. Not let anybody come do anything, we will be tolerant. That false notion of tolerance. And today false notion of intolerance. Both are false. Earlier was false notion of tolerance, we allowed the people to come in. And now today is false notion of intolerance. Where is intolerance? We simply created. So, how to be equanimous in these pairs of opposites? That's what the Gita is telling us. Here is a nice video of Gurudev on this verse.
This is only because of your contact, the right contact with the world outside, nothing wrong. In wrong contact that you get entangled with the world outside. Shitoshna sukadukhada, all your experiences of heat and cold, shitoshna sukadukha, joy and sorrow are all in the way you contact the world. There are some people, a little hot, oh, and you open the window. And they let it go, personally. You go on living and up. Shitoshna sukadukha, or joy and sorrow, success and failure, loss and gain, is all by way of contact with it, that these various experiences. And then what am I to do then? I am here in this world. Agama bayano anitya. These are all agama bay. They come and go. One moment hot, another moment cold. If you go on complaining, you can continue. A little, today something is very windy. Oh, really cold. And the day before yesterday was saying that it's very hot. Summer has come, I think. Half an hour, that's all. Now today, just the opposite. Something very cold outside. Breeze, breeze. Heat and cold. You really speaking, if you keep your ears open, it's wonderful to hear that. There is one delay. No rain at all, so no rain at all. And then let there be rain for 3 days. Shanti. Glory! Anything you complain. My people, you know, my father and mother, they don't care for me. All right, father and mother have landed. Somebody, they have landed, they are not going. They're not going. That's a complaint. Did the wife smile? I don't know why she is smiling so much. 6 inches smile, why should she? I think she is grinning at you. Now she doesn't smile. So very tragic. She is not smiling at all. You must, she must smile exactly the size that you expect her. Naturally, you are never happy. But she is an independent lady. She has got her own ways of smiling. You should have asked her before marriage that in a smile, let me see. No, that's not the right kind of smile. You understand? Give it up. All your own mental projects. Agama, Vayu, Anitya, they are impermanent. They are never there the same. They are Agama, Vayu. They come and go. Dham, hatred of heart. When they come to you, joy and sorrow, success and failure, dham, them, Dikshatva, suffer silently. Don't get perturbed by that. By the time you say that I am sick, you have to say that now I am all right. Last 2 days, you know, you are sick, very sick and all that. So the third day I meet you and say, hey, how are you now? Why? I am all right. Hey, but you were very sick. Oh, that was last week. Now I am all right. But last week he was dying, and this week he is planning the next marriage. Aren't you in your life also what? In your own silent heart have you what? Your friend crying, and you went there for the bereavement because his wife died. You also went. Third week, you'll get an invitation card. My marriage is coming. You know, when you go there, you don't know whether to weep or to smile. So you do both together. That person forgot. Agama, he comes and goes. And he tries to give you an explanation that, you know, it is not that I want to marry, but then the 2-3 children, small children, to look after them, this is the best babysitter available. home from one to the other. These are not to be, should not waste your time in running up and down. When joy comes, you go beyond the cloud. When sorrow comes, you come crash down. No, keep your balance. Let them come and go. But every one of us will be up and down. Even piece of wood is in the sea will have always the waves, and the wood is, what do you call that, floating on the waters. Naturally, that wood will have to go up and down according to the rhythm of the waves. Isn't it? But the same waves, or in the same waves, is standing the lighthouse at the harbor. The waves come and break themselves at the feet of the lighthouse, but the lighthouse is not going up and down. Why? Lighthouse is not floating on the surface, but it is built on the foundation of the rock down below. Therefore, the light illumines the waves. The waves come and clash and die away. But the lighthouse stands steady. May you all learn to live like a lighthouse. In the tumultuous changes of situations and circumstances and the world of change and tossing situations in the world, learn to keep your balance. How? By building your life on firm foundation. When all of us are going to close to each other, a little happiness in the mind, and next moment, and gone up and down. Agama, Vainoa, India, these are all impermanent. They come and go. No joy can permanently stay with you. No sorrow can permanently. Then what am I to do? Silently suffer. With dignity, with silent dignity, suffer them. Because you know they are not going to be permanent. They will go. Agama Vaino Nindya Tapti Diksha Sohara He Bharata Gurotama Tapti Diksha Sohara. Suffer them silently with the dignity and the patience. They will not be permanent. And enjoy yourself at night. And do achieve what you want to achieve in life without getting knocked down by all these different experiences.
So the example that you gave, no, about the waves and the lighthouse. So one thing Gurudev said is that be like a lighthouse in the ocean of the samsara. So build on the firm foundation if our life is built. So how to learn to accept things as they are, to remain balanced in the pairs of opposites. There are two aspects to this. One aspect is what we call as a stabilizer. When the mind gets disturbed, I need to hold on to something which will bring it back to its balance. It could be a mantra. It could be some reminder of my goal, some way to remind myself that what is my purpose in life? What is my goal in life? These things to harm me. If it is a mantra, I can just chant the mantra. Just imagine Prahlad, we are celebrating Holi today. His own father tried to kill him so many times. And what is that which he held on to? Was the mantra, the name of the Lord. His faith in the Lord is such that Prahlad literally means what? Prakarshena Ahladha Yasya Saha. One whose joy is supreme. In spite of circumstances, one who never becomes miserable, that person is called Prahlad. He could have been a victim. He could have said, I am a victim of child abuse. My own father is doing all this to me. Nothing. Held on to that mantra. When we celebrate Holi, it is a celebration of the faith of Prahlad. and burning away the defeat of Holika. So it could be a mantra that I chant the mantra. In some places, you know, they chant the whole stotra also. Vishnu Sahasranam stotram also one can chant. Any other stotra also, whichever you like. So it could be a stotra, it could be a mantra, it could be reminding that what is my goal in life. Or it could be breathing. Come back to deep breathing. You can also do what they call as a mantram walk. Walk briskly, chant the mantra fast. Synchronize the walking, chanting and breathing. If the mind is very disturbed and you need an outlet, then do brisk walking, chanting, breathing, synchronize that. And once the mind becomes a little quiet, revisit that experience and find out what went on. So it could be mantra, it could be breath, it could be goal, it could be any form of chanting that I do. It could be some visualization of things which make me relaxed. But these stabilizers I have to use when I have already been through some good times. In good times, if I use the stabilizer, in difficult times it will come to my rescue. Second, what we need is an anchor. So to go through life in equanimity, a certain attitudinal shift is required, not only some technique. One of the stabilizers also is you delay the response. As we said, you know, postpone the decision making. You delay the response. If you are very disturbed, don't reply to the email, don't reply to that SMS. For some time, don't, you know, maybe interact with that person. Move away from that place. Different stabilizers are there whereby I can make my mind come back to normal. Second attitude I said is the attitudinal shift. Second aspect of this is techniques can help me temporarily to quieten the mind. But what is the deeper cause? I have to identify that. And why was I not able to accept? One is acceptance is a deep anchor. But if I learn to accept life as it comes. So the mantra for acceptance is don't insist and resist. This has to be like this only. That attachment is what disturbs the mind. That is insistence. Psychological insistence. This does not mean that we don't have some standards or we don't expect a good quality. It doesn't mean that. It means psychologically the inability to accept something and getting disturbed. That I should drop. Small things can disturb our mind. Maid servant did not come. Over. This driver came late. Over. Small thing. For me, for you it is small thing. For you it is a big thing. A whole day we have to do so much work if maid servant is not there. Mind gets disturbed. But what can I do? It didn't come, didn't come. Now find the alternative and figure it out. What will disturbance do? So if I don't insist, unpredictable things will happen. Unexpected things will happen. I learn to take life in its stride. So don't insist and don't resist. Why this came to me? So what can I do? I may expect, but I also have to accept. Expect and accept is what Gita tells us. Even Karma Yoga part, when we come, we will see this. Gita doesn't say don't expect any result. Expect a result, work hard, but then having done the best, whatever result comes, we have to accept that result. If I can improve upon it next time, improve upon it. Nobody prevents that. So, attitudinal shift when it happens from non-acceptance to acceptance, equanimity will happen. From attachment to detachment. Attachment disturbs the mind. Even in summer, I want the temperature to be particular temperature only. Beyond that, if it goes, then I am disturbed. People get attached to so many things. They come to spiritual camps. You know, earlier when we used to have camps in Sidbari, that's near Dharamsala in Himachal Pradesh. Samadhi of Gurudev is there. So when they come and there used to be the hall where satsang happened, mostly people used to sit down. So in the hall there are some six pillars and people used to get attached to those pillars. they will come and they will sit and lean against that pillar. And if somebody else is sitting there, they will fight with that person. This is my pillar, get up from here. And what are they listening to? Lecture on detachment. Mind is like that, it gets attached so easily to people, to things, to habits, to small issues. That causes disturbance, equanimity goes. So detachment, one has to cultivate. Attachment to detachment, this non-acceptance to acceptance. Ignorance or false expectation to the right knowledge. Meaning, if I expect that in life there will be only one emotion or one way of living, it won't happen. There will be pairs of opposites. When I know, if I go to a desert, do I expect that there will be cool water I will get? If I find a oasis somewhere, there will be, that is an exception. But otherwise I go into the desert, it will be hot. So when I have false expectation, the disappointment is very natural. In this world when I live, there will be pairs of opposites. If we go to a, let us say, a theme park, entertainment park, which ride will we choose? That ride which is maximum having ups and downs and twists and turns and all that, we'll choose, no? And then we scream through that also and we get, you know, very excited also. And there are some videos also, no, people when they are in that, you should see their faces, how they are. But they enjoy that whole thing. At the end of it, when they come, they are like, wow, what a ride it was. And for that you have to pay and take a ticket and all that also. And Bhagwan is giving here free roller coaster ride to us. And we are saying, Are, why you are giving that this type of a ride? Why don't you give a plane ride to us? Sit in one chukchu gadi train, just go straight like that. What a contradiction of human mind. Success, failure, pleasure, pain, that will happen, it keeps going. Nobody is spared of it. So one who knows that very well will accept it. I don't have false expectation. If somebody is praising me, there will be 10 people who will criticize. I take it objectively and keep moving. That person alone is ready for higher knowledge, because otherwise petty things will occupy. Why this person didn't do this, why this person did that, all that will only occupy the mind. So if I want to experience immortality or these deeper spiritual aspects, definitely this acceptance is a big need. It's a qualification actually. Now we go to the theme, main theme back again in the Gita. This one thing in between Bhagavan has put only to understand that this reincarnation I have to understand, immortality I have to understand, then qualification is equanimity. So one question to all of us. Can we accept death, ignorance and unhappiness? Yes or no? I have to acknowledge that it's a reality. In that sense of acknowledgement, I may say that yes, I accept. But we are not comfortable with this. Death, ignorance and unhappiness. Why we are not comfortable with these three? If we have thought about it. Why cannot I be comfortable with death, ignorance and unhappiness?
Ego.
Ego, okay. Attachment. That is not my true nature.
False
identification. So we cannot accept something like death, ignorance and unhappiness, because that is not what I am. That's the nature of the body, mind and intellect. The BMI goes through that. And they will go through the opposite of that also. So birth of the body will happen, death will happen. Knowledge will be there, ignorance will be there. Unhappiness will be there, happiness will be there. That pairs of opposites affect the personality, the body, mind and the intellect. The personality has a choice to be affected by it or to remain in balance. But our true nature is beyond this personality. that which remains untouched by all these, which is only an illuminator of all this, like the screen of the movie is not affected by a romantic scene or a violent scene. It will remain unaffected, untouched. It is plain. The screen remains plain. So in the same way, there is one aspect of our personality, which is the pure self, which illumines the mind, which illumines the senses, which illumines the intellect, which does not get affected by any of these, which is immortal, which is beyond the pairs of opposites. Not knowing that, we identify with the personality and then go up and down with the personality. Hence it is that we strive to come back to our own true nature. So we cannot accept death, because immortality is my nature. We'll see how it is. The example here is, if dust falls into the eye, what will we do? There will be constant struggle, no? Because that dust particle is not the nature of this eye. Same way here in the river. The dust particles, the what you call stones, mud, all that which falls. The water in the river is pure water when it is flowing. Then it gathers things on its way, unnecessarily. But that is not the nature of the water. But when it goes and merges with the ocean, then it all becomes back to that clean water. It gets merged. It comes back to its nature as good water. Evaporates, again goes up. Impurities remain down only. Only that water goes up, gets purified again, comes down. Natural, what is it called? Recycling of water or filtering. Bhagavan has provided that system. But impurities remain here on. Because nature of water is pure. Same way our true nature is that. That we cannot accept death because we are immortal. We cannot accept ignorance. We want to know. What we want to know is a different thing. Somebody wants to know about politics. Somebody wants to know about something. Somebody wants to know about spirituality, about share market, whatever. But we want to know. And we cannot be unhappy. Because our nature is none of these three. And we always strive to come back to our nature. So, why should I know this self? Because death, ignorance and unhappiness is not my true nature. And because I identify falsely with the body as me, the individuality as me, I feel incomplete. And because I feel incomplete, I have desires. So there are two types of desires. One is called as a natural desire, inborn desire, and one is the cultivated desires. What are the natural or inborn desires? The desire for immortality is a natural desire. Everybody, is there anybody who wants to die? Even if somebody wants to die, what do they want actually? Freedom from trouble. They are not wanting to become non-existent. They are wanting to get away from this situation which they cannot deal with or it is tough. They are not wanting to become extinct. So, we don't want to die. Immortality is our inborn desire. Everybody has this inborn desire. Knowledge is an inborn desire. Happiness is an inborn desire. Greatness is an inborn desire. All these are inborn natural desires in us. And the cultivated desires are, that may be different for each one. Somebody may want a car, somebody may want money, somebody wants love, somebody wants fame. Those are cultivated desires, they come and they go. Inborn desires don't get satisfied like that. Any amount of things I achieve in the world, power I get in the world, wealth I get in the world, fame I get in the world, will the inborn desire get fulfilled? Will that make me immortal? We may think that it will make me immortal. So people want to be immortal by wealth, by money, by position, by fame. Relative immortality, their name continues maybe, but they themselves are not there. So none of the things in the world will ever fulfill the basic natural inborn desires that we have. If they cannot fulfill, people in the world, things in the world, then who will fulfill? It is not that we are We have to become immortal. Can I become immortal now? Because if I become immortal now, what was I? Perishable. And I will become perishable in future also. Immortality is yesterday, today, tomorrow, ever existing at all times. So that is the nature of immortality. Body came into existence at a particular time, body will die at a particular time. That is mortality. Immortality cannot be created, it is already existing. Pure knowledge is already existing. And infinite happiness is already present. We just don't know that. So the mind has to get introverted and tuned up to this reality, which is beyond the mind. Hence, this second chapter now speaks about from verse number 16 to 30 is the most famous and beautiful chapter of the Gita. Chapter 2 is verses on immortality of the soul. That each of us are the immortal soul. We are bodies. That famous saying that all of you must have heard. We are not a body with a soul, but we are the soul with a human body. Soul takes any form. It is by itself nameless, formless, attributeless. It is infinite. Its nature is Satchitananda. So that aspect is what this speaks about now. That the first aspect of our nature is Sat, pure existence. See the 16th verse of second chapter. Na sato vidyate bhavaha. Na bhavo vidyate sataha. Ubhayorapi drashtontastu. Anayostattva darshibhihi. It says, na asato vidyate bhavaha. That which is untruth has no existence. Na abhavo vidyate sataha. And that which is the truth has no non-existence. Meaning the truth will ever exist, the non-truth never exists. Untruth never exists, truth ever exists. Example, in the desert, the sand ever exists. But the mirage, does it exist? No, Swamiji, we saw it. Even if we saw it, what is it? It was an illusion. It never existed. So there are these three aspects. Sat, Asat, and Mithya. We should know this very clearly. What is the meaning of Sat? Sat is the truth or reality. And the definition of reality in Vedanta is that which ever exists in three periods of time and which is changeless, that is called Sat. So the rope ever exists. That rope has never become the snake. So that which exists yesterday, today, tomorrow, all the time there will be only the rope. No, but right now I am seeing the snake. That is our delusion. Rope has never become the snake. It is only appearing as the snake. So asat is that which ever exists in three periods of time. In us also there is that sat, pure existence. Can anybody experience their own non-existence? You try. Homework for this week. Experience your own non-existence. Come back and tell me. When did you experience your non-existence? In sleep, in deep sleep, in dream, in waking state, in any state, I have to exist or not? In the dream state, I am not aware of the body, but the mind is working. In deep sleep state, body also is not there, mind also is not there, intellect is not there, but am I absent? No. So I am, that pure I am is called as Sat, that ever exists. Only the form changes, body changes, thoughts change, emotions change. I am happy, I am tall, I am dark, I am young, I am handsome, I am... Descriptions of BMI will change, but I am will never change. Same way in the world outside, it is experienced as the isness. What does science say? Matter cannot be destroyed, right? You can only destroy the form. Isness cannot be destroyed. Energy cannot be destroyed. It can change form. So, When I cannot experience my own absence, that is my true nature. The mind's absence I experience, so I am different from the mind. So that immortal nature is my true nature. So when he says here, na asato vidyate bhavah, there is no existence of the untruth. So the definition of truth is what remains in three periods of time, which is changeless. Definition of untruth is that which never exists. In any period of time, it does not exist. Example, the son of a barren woman. Does he exist or not? Yes or no? No, never. Horns on the head of a man. Exist or not? Samji, I am an exception. No, there are no horns on the head of a man. Neither yesterday, nor today, nor tomorrow. It is not there. So, untruth is that which never exists. Dark, cold sun. Exists? S-U-N. No. Never. So many examples of untruth one can give, one can create. Because it never exists. And what is the third thing? That which does not exist but which only appears to be, that is called as a mithya or illusion. So the mirage in the desert, the snake on the rope, the ghost on the post. What I am seeing is actually the truth appearing to me as something else. So the sand is appearing as a mirage, the snake rope is appearing as a snake, the post is appearing as a ghost. So that is an appearance of the truth, but I am not seeing the truth as it is, hence it's an illusion. So these three things I should know very clearly, Sat, Asat and Mithya. So when he says here that na asato vidyate bhavah, and truth has never any existence. This body, mind and intellect right now, when I am seeing, and the world when I am experiencing, it appears very real to me. So it is, you cannot say it is untruth, it doesn't exist. But at the same time, one cannot say it is existing also. From the truth standpoint, this is not the truth because this changes. The world is not the truth because it changes. So what is not the truth and what is not the untruth is called as illusion. It's a temporary appearance. We have it even in the example of dream. While we are in the dream, it appears so real. But when we wake up, then we realize, oh, just a dream. So illusion can give us the false notion of reality. Like, oh, this is very real. But actually it is not real. So when he says this, Ubhayorapi drishtontastu, those who are wise people, they see the truth of both this, that untruth never has any existence and truth alone exists at all times. That's why our motto says Satyameva Jayate, the emblem of our country says Satyameva Jayate, truth alone wins. Na andritam, the untruth has no existence actually speaking. Even when somebody tells a lie, if it is known that this is a lie, nobody will believe it, no, after that. If somebody is believing it, they believe it only in the garb of truth. Because the other person thinks that this is the truth, so he is believing it. So, na asato vidyate bhava, na abhavo vidyate sata. It's a very powerful verse to say that BMI don't exist in higher standpoint. Right now, if they are appearing as an illusion. Our true nature is only that soul which is immortal. Just imagine people who understand this, they become so fearless. Khudiram Bose, no? He was one of the youngest freedom fighters, revolutionary freedom fighters, who was sentenced to death because he used a bomb. So when they took him to the gallows, he was a young 14-year-old boy. He walked up to the gallows happily. There was no trace of fear on his face. So the British officer there asked him that, do you know what is going to happen to you? He said, yes, you are going to hang me till death. He said, are you not scared? You are going to die? You know what he replied? He said, my mother has taught me that I am not this body, I am the immortal soul. The fire cannot burn me, the weapons cannot cleave me, the air cannot dry me, the water cannot wet me. I am that immortal soul. And as long as you don't leave my country, I will take birth again and again and again till I drive you out of this country. So this British officer got very angry. He said, from where did your mother teach you all this? So this boy said, this is written in the Gita. So who wrote the Gita? So Lord Krishna. So the British officer looks at this subordinate and he says, go and arrest this Krishna and get this book confiscated. It is spreading all these kind of things against us. What does he even know that who is Lord Krishna and what? But freedom fighters, so many of them inspired by this immortality of the soul, that truth alone exists. And I am that immortal soul. Bodies die, they come and they drop. The waves rise and they fall. The water doesn't go through any destruction. People who meditate on this lose their fear of death. That I am the immortal soul, I am not this body. And they prepare themselves for that death also. Because death is also the body, not mind. Second aspect is, our true nature is also chit. See the 16th verse, 17th verse, avinashitu tad vidhi yena sarvam idam tatam. Understand that there is one imperishable truth which pervades this whole universe. Vinasham avyasyasya nakaschit kartum arhasi. Nobody can destroy this imperishable, immortal truth. And in this commentary, Shankaracharya writes on this, even God cannot destroy this immortal truth. Why? Because that's his own nature. Na kaschit kartum arhasi. Nobody can destroy this immortal soul, including God, because God is immortal. Suppose he destroys himself, who knows that he destroyed it? Nobody will know. Some entity has to be there to know. That entity is an immortal. So, beautiful verses these are, that I will never become non-existent. And I am one with that Supreme Lord, my true nature, that immortal soul. So who meditates on this? This 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, all these verses, they are very powerful verses. 19th verse we will take. Yae nam veti hantaram. Yashchainam manyate hatam. Ubhautau na vijanitaha. Nayam hanti na hanyate. So he says, Yainam veti hantaram. Whoever thinks that this soul is the killer, Yashchainam manyate hatam. And who thinks that the other soul is getting killed, Ubhautau na vijanitaha. Both of them, they don't know. Why? Because the identity that I am a killer or the identity that I am the killed is identity belonging to the body or to the mind. It is not the soul. Soul doesn't do anything. It is infinite reality which pervades. Like the screen doesn't do anything. It is there. Movie gets projected on that. In that way, the immortal nature of ours, the doership and the actions, etc., happen by the equipment, the body, mind, the intellect. Like the petrol doesn't do anything. Who drives the car? Is the driver. Petrol is only present there, but without the petrol, the car won't move. Same way. In us, there is the immortal soul which does not do anything. So then who is killing? Suppose Arjun is killing Bhishma. Arjun the Jiva is killing Bhishma the Jiva. The soul in both of them is immortal. And the soul doesn't do any action. Neither the soul is killing, nor the soul gets killed. This doesn't mean that we go around killing anybody. The point here is that the duty, because if you kill, the punishment also will come to you. That time don't say that, why should punishment come? I am not killer. The jiva is the killer. The jiva will get the karma phala of that also. That I should be very clear. You know, this verse is so misunderstood by people. Nayam hantina hanyate. Neither the soul kills, nor the soul gets killed. There's one movie called Ux. In that, this serial killer is there who goes on killing people. And at the end of every murder, what does he say? कोई मारता नहीं, कोई मरता नहीं, ये मैंने नहीं कहा, गीता में कहा है। हॉरिबल इंटरप्रिटेशन। दिस वर्स टॉक्स अबाउट द हाईएस्ट फिलोसफी दैट वी आर नॉट द डूअर एंड हेंस अर्जुन डोंट टेक अप दिस बर्डन ऑफ डूअरशिप, यू हैव टू डू योर ड्यूटी टू प्रोटेक्ट राइटियसनेस, जस्ट फाइट द वॉर, डोंट फील गिल्टी दैट यू बिकेम द किलर ऑफ भीष्म, यू डिड इट नॉट बिकॉज ऑफ एनी पर्सनल रीजन। दैट्स द मोटिवेशन टू अर्जुन हियर, that from the soul standpoint of the soul, soul is immortal, so you must do your duty. And if you think that you are a jiva, that jiva also takes birth again and again, so don't hesitate, just do your duty. So these few verses are about the immortality of the soul. So our true nature is sat, immortal. Our true nature is also chit, awareness. We are not ignorant beings. Mind may be ignorant, but our true nature is knowledge by itself. That which illumines every thought in us is that pure consciousness. Gurudev used to give us a beautiful definition of thought. What is a thought? Thought is equal to object plus consciousness or awareness. So if I have a thought, this is a mic. There is an object called a mic, the form and the color and all that in my mind, the picture of that mic, the properties of that mic. And there is my awareness which is illuminating, because of which I know that this is a mic. So every thought is nothing but an object illumined by awareness. Objects, they come and they go, but awareness remains the same. Like the movie, the scenes go on changing, but the screen remains the same. In that way, that awareness in me, which sees the presence of thought, and which sees the absence of thought, which sees positive thought, negative thought, that remains untouched by any thought that comes and goes. That untouched presence in me, which is there even when no thoughts are existing in the deep sleep, that is called consciousness. That is chit. And when I know myself as chit, I remain untouched by anything that happens to me. A thought of anger comes, that thought of anger is in the mind, I am the sakshi of that anger. A thought of pride comes, love comes, happiness comes, I watch. So one of the ways to remain equanimous in pairs of opposites is be a sakshi, be a witness. They come and they go. For how long a thought remains? Very short time. If we don't feed it, it will die a natural death. Our problem is we keep feeding the thought. That is why we get bound by them. So, as Chaitanya, as pure consciousness, thoughts come, thoughts go, emotions come. I am only a witness, untouched, unaffected witness. So that is why I can remain equanimous, I can remain unaffected, I don't have to brand myself. It is not to justify anger or justify any such negativity that I must. As a mind, I must learn to overcome that. But why should I feel bad, or why should I feel excessively proud for anything good or anything negative? It is a quality of the mind. It remains and it goes. So as chit, I am untouched. And as anand, my true nature being infinite, there is no cause for sorrow. So happiness is my true nature. I don't need to become happy by getting something else. That which is infinite, that which is consciousness, there is no incompleteness in that. When there is no incompleteness in that, where is the question of any sorrow? So anand is my swarup. Anand is not because of something. Anand is my true nature at every moment. If I know this, I will become independent. I don't need to depend on things for happiness. And if I get a coffee, I will be happy. If I get this person, I will be happy. If I become successful, I will be happy. Mind may have those dependencies, and there is nothing wrong in wanting something, but to depend that because of that only I will be happy, then that is the source of misery. So these three, Sat, Chit and Anand, one who knows the self experiences these three, and their natural desire for immortality, for knowledge and for happiness gets fulfilled. So they attain a state of fulfillment, gaining which nothing remains to be gained. They act out of that, out of happiness. From there on, they they don't act for happiness. They act out of that state of happiness and bliss. Nothing can make them miserable, nothing can shake them up. That is the state the Gita tells us about the soul. So if I chant every day these verses from 16 to 30, these are very powerful verses to remind me of my own true nature as the soul. So this soul which is immortal is the very goal of life, to experience which we call as moksha. So moksha is not freedom and running away from duty, etc. It is the knowledge of my true nature as the soul. And that is why we chant the second chapter when somebody has passed on. If you can't chant the whole second chapter, chant these verses 16 to 30, which speak about immortality of the soul, about death, about reincarnation, etc. Why? Not only that it provides us clarity and strength, but it also helps the departed soul, because they are connected to our mind. Through our mind we are still connected to them, through our karma we are connected. And when we wish well for them and we chant these verses and let the meaning be understood and say that may this knowledge of the immortality of the soul help you, and it will. These are very powerful verses. So this whole second chapter, when Arjuna surrendered, then Bhagwan is giving him the advice. He is giving him different standpoints. One standpoint was reincarnation. Other standpoint is immortality of the soul. Now we go to one more aspect about this immortality, where this Gita speaks about death. Oh, just before that, how do I know this self? Purify the mind through karma yoga. Contemplate on the pointers of the self and you realize the truth. Simple path this is. Do service, purify the mind, contemplate on the self and get established in the truth. That's why in the second chapter we find the essence of the Gita is this. Why people say the second chapter is the essence of the Gita? Because the goal is provided here from verses 16 to 20, 30. The means, karma yoga, will come ahead as we go along. The means also is provided. What is the result of this person was established in the state? What is the way in which that person lives? The sthita pragna lakshan. That having discovered the Supreme Self, how is this person going to live? That also is provided in this. And the realization, direct means is contemplation. So how to contemplate on the self, that also is provided. That's why it is called the essence of the Gita. So now having said this about the immortality, we go into the inquiry about death. So one verse here in this Gita, two verses here in the Gita, they speak about what is death actually speaking. It is a fact of life to be faced. To take this verse 27 and 28. Jatasya hi mrityuhu dhruvam janma mrityasya cha tasmadaparihargethe natvam shochitum arhasi avyaktadini bhutani vyaktamadhyani bharata avyaktanidhananyeva tatrakaparidevana. So what is death? It is a fact of life that has to be faced. We cannot run away from it, we can't ignore it, we can't resist it. A fact of life is that which has to be faced. And when I have to face a fact of life, what do I have to do? Prepare myself for it. Because I can't run, I can't escape, I can't ignore, I cannot reject. I cannot resist. None of these I can do. I can only face it. So how to face it? By getting the proper knowledge about it. Because ignorance about what is death, as well as our attachment, that is what will cause the difficulty. So first thing that he tells us here is, that which is born, jatasya hi dhruvam mrityuhu, that which is born will die. ध्रुवम जन्म मृतस्य च एंड दैट व्हिच विल डाई विल अगेन बी रीबॉर्न तस्माद् अपरिहार्यते मत्वं शोचितुम् अर्हसि व्हेन दिस इज एन इनएविटेबल फैक्ट यू डोंट डिजर्व टू ग्रीव अर्जुन व्हाई आर यू ग्रीविंग As I said earlier classes, Gita is called Ashoka Upanishad because of these lines. Natvam, natvam shochitum arhati. Tatraka paridevana. Like that many verses come. So why should one grieve? We feel the loss, we feel sorry, we grieve, no doubt in that. It's natural, one can. But I have to finally accept it. That which is born will die. Meaning, if I think about it from my standpoint, individual also, each individual who is born will have to die. Am I ready for that? If today Bhagavan has to say, Chalo, your time is up, am I ready to drop? What are the things that I will hold on to? Those are my attachments. Am I ready to face death at this moment? Or even if not at this moment, suppose we say in a few years I know I have to die. Am I ready to face? Because that which is born will die. That's why we say people, we die, we live as though we are never going to die, and we die as though we have never lived. That's the tragedy of human life. We live as though we are never going to die. So oblivious, so ignorant. Is one of the wonders it is actually. In Mahabharata, you know. Yudhishthira is asked by Yaksha that what is the wonder in this world? He didn't say any seven wonders of the world. What did he say? Ahani ahani bhutani pravishanti yamalayam. Every day people are going into the abode of Lord Yama. Meaning every day people are dying. Shesha sthavaram icchanti. Still the other people, they feel that they are not going to die. Kimashtadya Mataparam, what can be a greater wonder than that? Just imagine what transformed Prince Siddharth. When he saw a dead person, when he saw a sick person, when he saw an old person, and then his charioteer did not show him that and stop. He added one more sentence. When Siddharth asked him, who is this? So the charioteer said, is a dead person. He could have stopped with that. What did he say? You will also die one day. This is a sick person, you will also fall sick. This is an old person, you will also become old. That shook him up. So that which is born has to die. Am I ready? Am I facing that? Ready to face that last journey of mine? At least of this body. And that which will be dead will be born again. You know, there is one movie called The Life of Pi. Have you seen? Must have seen. One of the most powerful lessons from that movie is there are no last goodbyes. Life doesn't give chance to say goodbye. When karma gets over, gone. In that movie, three times it happens. When the hero leaves Pondicherry and he goes, there's no time to say goodbye. He has to just go. When his family dies in that shipwreck, no time to say goodbye to parents. They are just drowned, they are dead. And finally he has traveled with that tiger for so long in that ship. He wants a closure. And he feels that, you know, tiger will look back. You know, like in Hindi romantic movies. He will turn. And when she turns, oh, everybody claps and all that. Life doesn't give any such opportunity. That tiger just went. He was like, Hare, I have built a bond with you, I have lived with you, and we are together in this hard thing, and nothing, tiger just jumped and went on. Where does life give chance to say goodbye? It doesn't give any chance. That's why the best thing is every moment when we are here, live together, live in peace, live in happiness, in harmony. Why fight over petty things? That which is born will die, that which is dead will be. Again reborn. If karma is there, it will be reborn. So have faith that we will come back to connect again and again. No, but we won't remember what we went through earlier. That's one way good, no? Bhagavan is giving you fresh opportunity to start again. Why you won't remember all that again and again? And is that not true every day? Forget death. Every day is not, is it every moment, is it not a new opportunity? Can we not make a new beginning in any relationship? We can, that's our choice, that freedom we have every moment. Death is only one comma in life, eternal sentence of life. It is not a full stop. It goes on. So, Jatasya hi Dhruva Mrityu. He says, so why are you grieving, Arjuna? Avyakta lini bhutani. So, what is birth? Birth is the state from unmanifest, you come to manifest. Avyakta lini bhutani. In the beginning, the being was unmanifest. In middle, he got manifest. And again, goes back to unmanifest. Death is from manifest to unmanifest. Birth is from unmanifest to manifest. The mud is the unmanifest state of the pot. Then from that mud, pot is born. And then you destroy the pot. The death of the pot is what? The pot going from manifest to unmanifest again. But does the mud die? No, mud does not die. That particular form of the pot got destroyed. So death is a very, sometimes it's unpleasant, it causes grief, sorrow, but I have to also know it is a fact, I have to prepare myself for it. And when somebody passes away also, I need to know it is their karma, they would go. Either they will go early or I will go early. How do I prepare myself for that? So from understanding standpoint, it is dropping of the body, which is no more appropriate for the soul. That's why the Gita gives this another powerful example, verse number 22, of changing the clothes. Vasamsi jirnani yatha vihaya navani grinhati naroparani tatha sharirani vihaya jirnani Anyani samyati navani dehi. It says Vasamsi jirnani yatha viha. The jiva is still living in the body. Because the karma of the body is like that, you cannot do anything. So some bodies they will drop very old, some bodies will drop young, some bodies will, like the seven children, brothers of Bhishma. As soon as born, Ganga put them in the river. Gone. Because they are eight vasus and they have been just cursed to take a form here. That much only karma is there. That karma gets exhausted, so they are gone. So that way, old does not mean old body only. Old means the body becomes incapable. So just like the body, just like the old clothes we give up, new clothes we take. But the person who is wearing, that remains the same. No? Does anybody grieve for old clothes going away? No. In fact, one waits when the new clothes will come. So in that same way here, when a soul has departed, we must know that this particular form for the soul is now completed. The karmic results are experienced by that soul, exhausted by the soul. Now the soul has taken a new body for its own journey ahead. So wish the soul well, pray for that departed soul. And may that soul take ahead its journey and experience peace and happiness. That should be the attitude that we have. And same thing we should know for ourselves also. That we also will drop this body at a particular point in time in this eternal journey. Choice we have is, do we want to come back here again? Or do we want to experience that immortal nature of ours? That's the only two things we can do. Either be bound in the cycle of birth and death. That which is born will die, that which is dead will be again born. Or realize that which is birthless and deathless. Only two choices are. One who understands that very well may feel the loss. But as he says here, Anyani samyati navani dehi. The body will keep, the jiva will keep taking new bodies. So why grieve? Unless I don't experience the supreme reality, I will keep taking new bodies. The cycle of birth and death goes on. So hence, about death, once I understand this fact, that it is actually the transfer of vasanas, intellect and mind. What we spoke about last time, the BMI chart. From one body into another, from one bucket into another, just as a memory aid. whim goes from one body to another. Or like the SIM card goes from one phone to another. It is like that. Intellectually, maybe this is at least the information that I must know. How much I am detached, that will ensure how balanced I am in these tough situations of life. So in this BMI chart, VIM go from one body into another. The individual, the PFT, the perceiver, feeler and thinker, Mr. So-and-so, with VIM, goes from one body to another. The OM doesn't go anywhere. OM is already all pervasive. OM is the immortal nature of ours, which is our true reality. That OM identifying with one M and I becomes the PFT, the Jiva. And that PFT along with VIM keeps on taking new bodies. That is the Jivatma, upper one. The OM is the Atma. So immortal nature, 16 to 30, these verses which speak about immortality, death, etc., they are about OM. That as OM, I am immortal. As a Jiva also, I am relatively immortal because I keep taking new bodies. The death of the body doesn't mean my death. So one question to ask is, who dies?
The body.
You will say body dies. The Jiva dies?
No.
No. Can the self die?
No.
No. Self does not die, Jiva does not die, body? Actually speaking, body also cannot die. Because body is already dead. It is only five elements. It is like this, this mic. Can you say the mic dies? The mic is already dead. No, Swamiji, but this mic and this body is a big difference. No, what is the difference? The difference is only that this mic doesn't have mind and intellect. We have a mind and intellect. If you introduce mind and intellect inside this, what will happen? This will also become alive. So literally speaking, if this is an intellectual analysis, okay, don't feel. This is to give clarity. Don't say, "Are you what, Swamiji? What you are not? You are just ridiculing death." No. This is to give clarity that who actually dies and what are we grieving for? You think about it. We grieve for our attachment, unfortunately. Because the body is dead, it cannot die. The Jiva is continuing. Self cannot die. Then who has died? From higher standpoint, Mahatmas, they say that death itself is an illusion. It is like exactly the changing of clothes now. Why will I grieve? Old clothes I have discarded. New clothes I am taking up. I, the individual, is continuing. So why do we grieve then? We grieve for our attachment. Because this particular person in this particular form with particular experiences I had, that person is not there anymore now. Or I will not be there anymore, so I will not be able to enjoy with these people around me. So I miss that and I feel sad for that. And there's nothing wrong about it. We are just trying to understand this whole process. And if I understand very well that karma will bring us together, we will relate again, and we will relate with a similar emotional background. Just that we don't know particular instances. Don't we see people who meet each other and then they say what? Swamiji, we met and from the first meeting we just connected, you know, our vibes just matched. And then there are people who are 20 years together and then suddenly they say now, poles apart. Why? Because karma is over now, that's all. So we will meet again also. And we will have similar emotional relationship also. And if you don't want a similar one, you want to change, that also will change. Because the Jiva has that power. So what we really grieve for, that's why Bhagavan goes on saying that, why are you grieving? Natvam shochitam arhasi. Don't grieve. For some time we may feel sorrow. No doubt. We need to accept, learn and move on. Hence, Gurudev always used to say, no, everybody dies, and he will say it loudly in his talk, everybody dies. So all the people who are asleep also will get up. What happened? Everybody dies. Every time, two, three times he will say that and then he'll whisper slowly. Everybody dies, but no one dies. Why no one dies? Because that one truth in the hearts of all is immortal. And Jiva doesn't die, that truth doesn't die, body is dead which cannot die, so no one dies actually. And how much tamasha happens on that? In our culture, we actually celebrate death. Why we celebrate death? Because that person has gone to the next level. Exhausted certain karma, gone to the next level. It's like a promotion. Person went. Now why grieve for that? Hence these verses, very very powerful verses on immortality of the soul. We will conclude with these two verses, which are the famous ones, 23rd and 24th. Nainam chindanti shastrani. Nainam dahati pavakaha.
Nainam dahati pavakaha.
Nachainam kledayantyapaha.
Nachainam kledayantyapaha.
Nashoshayati marutaha.
Nashoshayati marutaha.
Achedyoyamadahyoyam. Akledyo shoshya evacha.
Akledyo shoshya evacha.
Nitya sarvagata sthanuho.
Nitya sarvagata sthanuho.
Achaloyam sanatanaha.
Achaloyam sanatanaha.
So it says, nainam chindanti shastrani, the weapons cleave it not. Nachainam nadhati, nainam dhati pavakaha, the wind does not drive. Sorry, pavaka is fire. Nachainam kledayam tyapaha. The water will not wet it. And nashoshayati marutaha. The wind will not dry it. This space, you know, can the space be cut by any weapons? Can the space become wet? Space is a fifth element. The subtlest element is space. Air, fire, water, earth, they cannot touch space. Then what to talk about the consciousness, which is the cause of space also. Nothing can be touching that consciousness. Hence, that is our true nature. So we say that self cannot be cut, cannot be burned, cannot be wet, cannot be dried. It is immortal, it is stable, it is that which is eternal. I have to tune up my mind to that, using these pointers. It is not that there is some soul who is like that. This is talking about me, each individual. Our nature is that soul. So with this, the second chapter, one part is completed in this Gita, where it speaks about immortality. We had seen in the last class that there are five perspectives that Bhagavan gives to Arjun, that from all the five perspectives he should fight the world. So we have seen the first two, that the jiva continues, so don't resist or don't avoid your duty. Soul is also immortal. He says from your Swadharma standpoint, Swadharma mapi chaveksha navikampitu madhasi. You are a Kshatriya, you must fight the war. From social perspective, that as a leader, people are going to follow you, Arjun. Don't set a wrong example for them. And they will unnecessarily talk bad about you. Akirtim chavi bhutani kathayishyanti te ganam. They will say you ran away. Bhayadranadu paratam manyati. They will think that you just ran away. What will they think? And for a Kshatriya, this type of a dishonor is worse than death. How will you live your life? A soldier, for him, honor is everything. If he becomes an escapist, he doesn't fight, doesn't do his duty, that is dishonor for him. So he says, don't get into that state. And from material perspective also, hatova prapsyasi swargam. If you are killed, you will get Veer Swarga, heaven. Jitvava Bhokshase Mahim. You will get this pleasures of this kingdom here. From all these standpoints, Arjun, you must do your duty. So having said that, the next part of the second chapter, Bhagavan goes on to explain about Karma Yoga. That we will take up in our further session. For today we will stop here. This completes the lesson number 3. So you are free now to take up the test on lesson number 3. We will enter into lesson number 4 next week. You can please read lesson number 4 and come. The dates I have already given to you for all the upcoming sessions. So we will follow that. some people may not have taken the lessons 4 to 10. If you have not taken, you please take it. They will be given to you. And wish you all a very happy Holi. By the grace of the Lord, increase our faith, like may we have more faith like Prahlad had. Holi is celebrated for 3 reasons. One is the Dahan of Holika. So, second is Lord Shiva destroyed Kamdev on that day. So it's a victory of the seeker over lust and passion. And on that day, Shri Krishna and Radha ji, you know, it is said Bhagwan went and complained to Yashoda ji that Radha is so fair and I am so black. So then Yashoda ji says, this Ranga Panchami day, na, so you apply color on Radha also and make her also, she should not look fair for you. So you apply color. So then Krishna and Radha also, their love is immortalized for Holi. So may the devotion towards Lord Krishna, may the faith that Prahlad had, and may the victory of Lord Shiva over lust, may all these 3 inspire us and have a great Holi. Madam Purnamidam Purnat Purnamidachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Hari Om Shri.